Okay, welcome to the next session. We have the other microprocessor for the Apple II, and we have our speaker, Jay Graham. Take it away, Jay.
Okay. All right, thank you. So what I want to talk a little bit about this morning is the second microprocessor for the Apple II. Turn this and put this a little bit further away. Okay, yeah, because probably don't even need a mic. But so as you all probably know, there were a lot of processor boards and coprocessor boards that were made for the Apple II. There was the Stellation Mill, which was a 6809. There was a 68000. The most popular one, though, was the Microsoft Soft Card, which spawned a whole bunch of Z80 lookalikes, clones, and ones from different manufacturers. So what I wanted to talk a little bit about this morning was a brief history of the Z80, a brief history of CPM, how CPM came into being, the Apple CPM card solutions that are available and that are past and present. Believe it or not, there are people building clones and knockoffs of them now. Where you can get a vast array of CPM software, and talk a little bit about that. And then at the end, if there's time, we'll do a quick demo on the emulator here. So where did the Z80 CPU come from? One of my pet peeves, I just wanted to sidetrack here for a minute, is audiobooks. When you're reading technical audiobooks or listening to them in the car, the one thing that really kills me is when people butcher names of and acronyms and so forth. So the inventor of the Z80 CPU is Federico Fagin, and you can imagine how the audiobooks butcher that name with the spelling there. So, and honest to God, they did, when you talk about it. So, again, the Z80, Federico actually worked at Intel, and he worked on the design of the 4004, which was the first Intel microprocessor, and the 8080, which we all know was in the MIDS Altair, and that was kind of the processor that started it all for them. Well, he left Intel, and with a gentleman by the name of Ralph Ungerman from Ungerman Bass, who, as we heard later on with networking, they basically developed the Z80 and started conceiving this as a processor in late 1974, and it was an extension of the 8080, so it was basically binary compatible with the 8080. It was aimed for embedded systems, although it had a completely different use in the end than what they envisioned early on. So they made a whole set of peripheral chips with it, and they wanted to use it in various embedded systems. And it did see use there, but it saw its largest use in the microcomputer industry. It was officially introduced in July of 1976, so right for the bicentennial, and it basically came into wide use in the microcomputers, and everybody picked this up, and it actually was pretty big in video games back in the 70s and 80s. It was a processor that was used there, and I'll talk a little bit about that later. Zilog was the company that made it. They licensed manufacturing to Synertec and Mostec, who everybody knows Mostec from the 6502. And it basically improved over the 8080 and the 8085 by enhancing the instruction set. It had a better interrupt system, and less hardware was required to implement it. It actually used a single plus 5-volt power supply. It didn't need multiple voltages like some of the other processors did, and the clock and the I.O. was real easy to implement on. This is, I'm not going to get into the assembly language or in any detail today because I have 45 minutes, so and there's a bunch you can learn about this just by Googling it online. I'll make this presentation available online, and I have some URLs at the end that can guide you to different places. But the Z80 basically, it paired 8-bit registers to, you know, basically to generate 16-bit registers and 16-bit versions of the registers in there. It actually had a unique feature where with the fetch execute overlapping, it was called. So it could actually be executing one instruction while it was fetching the next. So the kind of the old day version of Spectre and Meltdown. it had a unique feature for doing that. It also had its own set of undocumented opcodes, illegal opcodes, and bugs in it as well. There were roughly 252 opcodes, and this is kind of what the register structure looks like. For anybody that wants to see what the silicon looks like, this is a version of the Z80 and what the design of it looks like. Interestingly enough, ROM Magazine, which was an old magazine back in the day, they had a centerfold in the magazine, like R2-D2 was the centerfold. The Z80 was actually the centerfold in one of the ROM magazines. This picture right here, somebody has it. So I actually have that, and I have it framed at home, and I have the Z80 on the wall with the centerfold with that. So here are two people that we should know for the Apple II. The one on the right, I think we all know, that's Chuck Peddle. He was the actual designer of the 6502. And that's, you know, when Wozniak wandered up to the suite in the West Coast Computer Fair, plopped down his $20, got the 6502 instead of implementing it with the 6800, which was about $300 back then, and the rest is history. And the guy on the left is actually Federico Fagin, and he was heavily involved in the chip design. It was interesting because he was the CEO of the company, but he was working like 80-hour weeks to actually get, along with two other designers, to actually get the design done for the Z80 in order to meet the schedule that they put out. This is what the package looks like in the DIP40 configuration. Believe it or not, there are variants of the Z80 that are still around today, and you probably can find it in every package known to man for a surface mount. But this was the DIP40 that we would see on all of the various cards for the Apple II. And there's a side-by-side comparison of the Z80 and the 6502. And here are some of the vendors that actually utilized the Z80 back then. Coleco used it. Xerox obviously used it in their 820. Heathkit. Timex Sinclair. Everybody knows the Sinclair ZX80 and ZX81 that used it. Obviously Radio Shack with the TRS-80 back then. MSI. K-Pro and Osborne with their luggables actually used the Z80 processor, MITS, Commodore. Interestingly enough, if anybody remembers the old NEC V20 and V30 chips, which were MS-DOS chips that actually ran MS-DOS, they did have an emulation mode that would allow you to run the CPM86 version. And the other one, does anybody know that logo that I have the arrow pointing to? Somebody does, in the back. Yes, BBC Micro.
Come listen to my talk tomorrow.
yeah. So that I really like the logo. So I put the logo up there. But they actually used a Z80 processor, and there's a picture of it right there. And the interesting thing, I don't have time today, but Acorn Computers was the design of that.
And,
okay. Okay. Well, So everybody knows Acorn from the ARM, which is used in a lot of these devices today. And ARM actually stands for Acorn RISC Machine. So they got into the RISC business. And that in and of itself, you could do a Kansas Fest, although it doesn't have to do with the Apple except for the iPhone and that. But there is an interesting story there, and I highly recommend that you go Google that and read that, or talk to the gentleman in the back there, the Acorn RISC Machine. So interesting story. What's that? Z80, yes, the Z80. So, yeah, that's true. So let's talk a little bit about the CPM history then. That's kind of, again, there's tons out there on the Z80, so you can Google it and you can read everything from where it came from to where it is today. And so along parallel with that, there was a gentleman who was designing and developing CPM. So CPM stood for Control Program and Monitor initially, but then later was changed to Control Program for Microcomputers. It was created, obviously, for the Intel 8080 and the 8085 by a gentleman named Gary Kildall, who we all might know and have seen, so I'll talk a little bit about him. It was a single-tasking 64K of RAM, 8-bit operating system, MITS Altair, was probably one of the first, to use it. And as we all know, the story, how it was displaced by MS-DOS in the early 80s, and I'll talk a little bit about that later when we talk about Gary Kildall. So here's Gary Kildall, born in Seattle, Washington. And he attended the University of Washington, and he was pursuing a degree in mathematics. He worked as a consultant, actually, for Intel as well. So he worked on the 4004, roughly about the same time that Federico was there, and developed the first high-level programming language, which was called PLM, and he used, actually, PLM to write CPM. So he demoed this CPM for Intel and said, hey, look, I have this operating system. Do you guys want to do anything with it? And they basically had, no, we don't really have any interest in this. And the reason for that is because Gordon Moore at the time from Intel, they were in the processor business. They really weren't in the PC business. So when people were developing the PCs, which needed these operating systems, Gordon Moore was always flipping out about that and saying, no, we want to sell the processors so that our customers can build the PCs, but we don't want to build PCs ourselves. So he formed a company called Intergalactic Digital Research, and later on they renamed it and filed for a name change for just Digital Research, and they dropped off the Intergalactic. And by 1982, it was interesting because CPM was running over 3,000 different hardware platforms. So it is probably the most ubiquitous operating system around. The Apple II was one of them. And yay. And of course, everybody knows the PC DOS story when Gary went flying, as Bill Gates called it. Gary was on a business trip that day when IBM came to the door, and his wife and business partner, Dorothy McEwen, and she didn't take his last name because she didn't want to be associated with Gary Kildall and wanted to, be on her own and not be associated with the CPM and the operating system. So she would not sign the non-disclosure agreement that IBM basically. And there's variations of this story, since some of it's probably folklore at this point, but basically didn't sign the disclosure. Eventually they talked, and Gary wanted to say, IBM wanted to buy CPM outright for a disclosed sum. Gary said, no, I want royalties. When it sells with every PC, I'd like a royalty, and IBM said no. Well, then they went to Bill Gates, and Bill Gates said, I'd like royalty with everyone that is sold, and they said yes to him when they went to DOS. So it's like, okay. Then later on in life, with what Gary did was he came up with a graphical interface called GEM, and that was a Digital Research product, and found himself getting in trouble with Apple with that one. So much to the fact that on the Apple II, they actually had to remove the trash can icon from the GEM operating system. Although the Atari, they were able to keep it on there because Apple didn't think Atari was going to, compete with them. So they didn't have the Atari actually remove the trash can. And actually, there were multi-windowed. So it was a multi-windowed operating system. And on the Apple, they had to make it so that it only opened up two windows. He also hosted a show that we probably have all watched, Computer Chronicles, with Stuart Chaffé. He was on that for many years. And then, as we may or may not know, Novell acquired DRI, or Digital Research, in 1981, and that's where he pretty much made his millions when they acquired that, and then died mysteriously in 1994. And again, a lot of folklore and things out there on how he passed away. So, as I said, it was developed in 1974. There was a large library of software out there. And actually, a lot of the interesting features that were in MS-DOS actually were born in CPM. So drive letters, CPM used A colon and B colon, just like DOS did. They pioneered the 8.3 file name, so 8 characters and a 3-character extension. The wildcards were actually in CPM. Device names, like PRN for printer and CON for console. And Control Z, which was essentially the end of file, and there are others, but those are the major ones. So when they originally developed CPM in 1974, and when he went to Intel, this was a prototype box that Intel had, and they were interfacing this with a Shugart 8-inch floppy drive, and Gary developed CPM for this. And again, they didn't really call this a computer; it was an Intel development environment. So this is essentially when he talked to Intel, what they said, we really don't see a use for CPM. So some of the commercial software titles that are available at the time, Microsoft essentially, and we'll get to the soft card in a minute, and I'll tell you why they wanted to develop that. But Microsoft had a lot of languages out there that were written in CPM, COBOL, Fortran, Aztec C, which is a big C compiler. Of course, Borland had Turbo Pascal and Modula 2. There was actually an Ada compiler, a MUMPS compiler and interpreter, if anybody knows what that is. And there were various BASIC versions that came out, the MBASIC from Microsoft and then the CBASIC from Gordon Eubanks back then, who was working with Gary Kildall. Word processors, there was WordStar, Tex, T-Maker, and Magic Wand Word Processor, believe it or not. That's not a well-known one, but WordStar we've probably all used. Databases, DBase2, and What's It? And I don't know if anybody knows the story of What's It, but that's another interesting one to Google. That's actually an acronym of, wow, how did all that stuff get in there? And actually, it was a free-form database back then, which was kind of innovative for 1975 when they developed this. So it was kind of like the Hadoop of the 70s, because it was a free-form database. And basically, the story is that there was a gentleman Lyle Morrell from Computer Headwear Software that designed this, went to the 1978 West Coast Computer Fair with Sharpie-signed signs, handwritten disk labels, and he was selling this software. And his booth didn't look really professional, but lo and behold, next door, he was with IBM, with 3 men in pinstripe suits, all of the gold and silver rails and signs and all of that there. And those 3 gentlemen in the suits stood around all day watching hundreds and thousands of people come to this guy's booth and buy this What's It software. They didn't even have a cash drawer, the story goes, and he had cash all over the table because people were just buying up this piece of software, and actually it ran on the Apple II. Business software, Microsoft MultiPlan and SuperCalc, we all know what those are, and games. Believe it or not, there were games for CPM. They weren't graphical in nature. But Nemesis was a Dungeons and Dragons game. Sargon Chess was actually developed on CPM before it went to all of the millions of other platforms. Zork 1, 2, and 3. And then there were numerous basic games that were available. So this is actually what the Sargon 2 chess game looked like. It was text-based, and then you used Escape to view the board. So on the Apple II, you could actually view the graphics on the board. Some of the other ones, which I think it was the Wavetronics or something, Jupiter 3, which was the first computer that was on, didn't have any graphics, so there was only a text version of it. So there are three components to CPM. There's the BIOS, the BDOS, and the CCP. And everybody probably has heard the word BIOS, Basic Input Output System. And BDOS was the basic disk operating system, and CCP was the console command processor. Now, the unique feature and why CPM was ported to so many hardware platforms is that essentially the BDOS and the CCP was the same. That was written at a higher level. And you know, we hear about it today. It's called like the hardware abstraction layer, or the HAL. So that was written at a lot higher level, and the BIOS was the low-level glue that tied that high level together with the actual hardware itself. So when you ported it to a new platform, you really had to only rewrite the BIOS, because the BDOS and the CCP were essentially, you know, unchanged on that. The console command processor was responsible for interpreting the commands and actually taking actions on it. And we'll talk a little bit about that later. There were intrinsic commands that were in CPM, and then there were external ones. Intrinsic ones were part of the operating system. When the operating system booted up, didn't have to go to disk to run a program, where the external ones did. It also came with an interesting debugging tool called DDT, the dynamic debugging tool, but it was also like the big jokes were going around with the pesticide and so forth back then, the bug killer. So it actually was a pretty full-featured one in CPM back then. I mean, we have a lot better ones today, but for what you got back then, you could actually debug programs and so forth, single step through them. So there was some interesting things there as well. So the first public version of CPM was version 1.4, and there was a version 2.2 and a 3.0. Apple had some unique versions, CPAM 4.0 and 5.1, A standing for Applied Engineering. So I don't know whether that was control program for Applied Engineering outfitted microcomputers or something like that, but they decided to put the A in there on their version. And it actually, some of the versions had ProDOS support, so you could actually, and I'll talk a little bit if there's time at the end, how you could actually develop or format a ProDOS partition and actually run CPM from ProDOS. The versions got better as they went along. Version 3 and the CPAM versions, which I'll demo those at the end here, probably were the most full-featured. Now let's talk a little bit about the CPM and the DOS command comparisons. So the stars or the asterisks on here are the ones that denote the intrinsic commands. So those are the ones that are internal to the operating system. So DIR is pretty much the way it worked in DOS. DIR, drive letter, and then the file spec. And you could use the wildcards of asterisk and question mark. Asterisk representing a string of characters, question mark representing a single character, wildcard. The type command was in both of them, and it was basically type in a file spec. CPM had ED, which was a fantastic state-of-the-art line editor, and had its own set of cryptic commands. And of course, DOS, we all know, had EDLIN. Erase was the command in CPM to get rid of a file, could be abbreviated with three letters, ERA, and you gave it a file spec, and DEL was the DOS version of it. And if you wanted to confirm, you had basically put the word confirm after the erase command, and it would ask, do you really want to delete it, where, you know, in the later versions of DOS, you did the slash Y. So pretty much, you know, it makes sense up to that point. Now we get to the one which is the copy command. And CPM had a program called PIP, Peripheral Interchange Program. Came back from the old days of RTS11 and OS08 from the DEC 10s. There was a command on there. And it did a little bit more than the copy command did, but it's kind of like the copy command because that's what you use to move files from different disks. You could print to the printer from it. You could use, you know, console devices and so forth. And then you have the copy command in DOS. Does anybody see something unique about those two commands? Yeah. AB, ass backwards. So, so this killed me when I was going from CPM to DOS. I can't tell you how many times I overwrote files. With pip, the destination went first, and the source came second. So pip A colon equals B colon star dot star. That moved files from the B drive to the A drive. Copy A colon space B colon star dot star did it exactly the opposite in DOS. So that, and it still confuses me to this day, because I had one of these soft cards from my Apple II when I got it, and it still got to think when I'm ever issuing a copy command at the command line. Thank God for drag and drop. so yeah, because yeah, what's that? Yeah. Thank God for drag and drop. So rename, there was a rename in the ren command. Again, most of the CPM commands could be abbreviated to the first three letters, so that was about the same. There was kind of a rudimentary batch file processing in CPM. It was called submit. The file had to end in a .sub extension, but you could put CPM commands in there and do submit space and then the file name, and it would execute the CPM commands in order. Obviously, today we know that in DOS, in batch files, you put the commands, or a .bat or a .cmd file. Now, the interesting thing about CPM is that there was no subdirectories, kinda. so in MS-DOS, you know, and in Windows and so forth, we create folders and subdirectories all the time and don't give it a thought. Well, in CPM, there wasn't such a thing. There was no way to create subdirectories, but there was a user command. And what the user command did, the N, or after that, was a number from 0 to 15, and user 0 was kind of the master user. That was the master user of the file system. So if I walked up to a CPM machine and I did user space 1 and then did a DIR, I would see all of the files that were in the user 0 section of the file system. However, if I created any files in ed or any of the software, and I saved it to the diskette or the disk at that point, I would be the only one that would see the files in user 1. So I'd have to do user space 1, and then I would see the files that I created. If I do user space 0 and went back to the master file system and did a DIR, wouldn't see those files. Now, was there a password on it? No. I mean, somebody could walk up and do user 1, and then they would be able to see my files. But the interesting thing is that a lot of the commands, and I left it out for brevity here, a lot of the commands had a GN after it, where if I wanted to, if I was in user area 2 and I wanted to copy a file from user area 1, I could put a parameter on the pip command that would actually say, please look for this file not only on drive A, but in user area 1. So it was kind of a poor man's subdirectory structure. And then stat was the command that would actually check the disk at that point. It wasn't as full-featured as check disk was, so it didn't look for bad sectors or any of that type of thing. But it would, nonetheless, was a command. So that brings us to why the Apple II. Well, that was one of Paul Allen's idea at Microsoft. Again, remember what I said earlier, Microsoft went out and wrote all of these programming languages for the CPM systems like the MITS, Altair, and so forth, and they wrote them all in CPM, and they said, gee, we should make it easy to port these to the Apple. You know, the Apple, there's thousands and thousands and thousands and millions of Apple users out there. We should make all of this CPM software available to them. So he had the idea, and the card itself was developed by Tim Patterson, yes, from Seattle Computer Products, guy, the DOS guy, and Bill Gates. And actually it was manufactured and redesigned by another company, Bertronix or something like that. Don Burtis was a guy that redeveloped it. He was an engineer and redeveloped the card. And again, you know, as I said, it was trying to simplify the porting of Microsoft's languages. And it was demonstrated at the West Coast Computer Fair in 1980. And Steve and I were talking about it right before the break. This was the cash cow for Microsoft back then. This is what brought all of their revenue in. And the card went, it was Microsoft Soft Card, went for $349 back then. You plugged it into your Apple II, and I did a calculation in 2018 dollars, and that's like $1,000, in 2018 dollars. And it essentially made the Apple II the most widely used CPM platform around, blowing all of the other ones away. Now, let's talk about some of the options for the Apple II. Obviously, this was the first option that was available, was the good old Microsoft Soft Card when it came out. Microsoft could not keep up with the demand for these things, and because everybody saw them, although they demoed it at the West Coast Computer Fair, they basically took business cards because they didn't have the product at that time, and they didn't realize, it was one of those things where they didn't really realize how popular this was going to be. So there are essentially two types of these cards. One of them is the soft card style, and this basically suspends the 6502 via a DMA line and takes over the bus of the Apple II at that point, and it has direct access to all of the Apple II hardware. And some of the examples of this are obviously the Microsoft Soft Card, the Applied Engineering Z80 Plus, which I actually have one in a box here, and then Ian Kim's Turbo 7, which is a soft card clone. That's kind of a modern day soft card clone of the Z80. And you can tell by the CLPD that's in there. The second type of card that was available, which was the single board computer. So what this was, this functioned independently of the 6502. They typically had onboard RAM, 64K. Some of them had 64K and a 64K expansion on it. And it's interesting because a lot of these boards, when you weren't using the Z80 processor, you could use the extra RAM on there as a RAM disk. A lot of the companies wrote drivers so that you could use that as a RAM disk when you weren't using the Z80. The Z80s on the soft card model were clocked relatively low. They were, you know, the 1 megahertz and so forth. On the single board computers, they developed and clocked these babies at anywhere from 4 to 6 megahertz, which was like flying back then. The drawback is they really had no direct access to the Apple hardware. Drivers had to be written for everything. And they typically plugged in the auxiliary slot of the Apple IIe, and there were some that were made for the normal slot. Some examples of these are the Personal Computer Peripherals Inc. AppliCard, and the AppliCard, in my opinion, that is kind of the Cadillac of the CPM. It was expensive back then, but that's the Cadillac of the CPM cards for the Apple. And I have a few of them here, and anybody that wants to stop by later, I can, you know, show them the software and so forth for that. But that one was kind of the Cadillac. And interestingly enough, there were three different versions of this card made, although they were really the same. One of them was the one that PCPI sold to the users with the CPM software. And the other one was called the Star Card. And it was the same card. It was just bundled with WordStar, and I think it was, you know, SpellStar or one of those things. So it was the same card. So good old Seymour Rubenstein, who developed WordStar, decided, you know, we could sell more WordStar if we partnered with this company and sold our WordStar and SpellStar along with this. The other one was Franklin Computer, actually came to them and said, we would like a version of this for the Franklin. Again, it was the same, same card, but it sported the Franklin logo on it. Then Microsoft, with the success of the original soft card, came out with a soft card 2E. This card plugged into the auxiliary slot on the Apple IIe. It did the 80 column, you know, card, and had some RAM on it as well, and did the did the CPM as well on that. This card, I don't know if anybody's ever seen one. I have one here, and I'll show you. It is a huge card. It is long and it is tall. So if you did what I did and you take an Apple II Platinum motherboard and you stick it in an original Apple II case like I did, this SoftCard 2E will not fit. There is no way to wedge it in there because the Platinum case might have been just an inch longer or a half inch longer on there. So I can't get my Platinum or my SoftCard 2E in my Frankenstein Apple II there. Advanced Logic Systems was another company that made a pretty robust CPM card and called it the CPM card, very creative there. And again, it had RAM on board as well, but that was one that fit in a regular slot. The only one on this picture that fit in the auxiliary slot was the Microsoft card. The other ones fit in a regular slot. Not to leave out the good old Apple IIc, there were three options available that I know of for the Apple IIc. There might have been more. Two of them were by Applied Engineering, and one of them was from a company called Certec. I didn't put a picture of that one up there because, by far, these are the most popular. My Apple IIc up here has one of the ZRAM Ultra 3s in it, which gave you RAM, CPM, Z80 to run CPM, and a clock and calendar with a battery on it. That in the Apple IIc really made a kick-butt Apple IIc. And the other nice thing on that card is that the Applied Engineering also sold the 65812 upgrade on there, and I actually have that in there. So I'm running that processor in there instead of the 6502. Applied Engineering also just made a Z80 card that fit in the Apple IIc. One side note, I can tell you the ZRAM Ultra 3, when I took my Apple IIc apart to clean it and had to put that back in, that is not an easy board to install in the Apple II. You have to remove the 6502 off the motherboard, and then there's a socket on the bottom of this board that you cannot see because it spreads the whole length of the keyboard, and you have to get that seated exactly right in there. Then the 6502, or the processor upgrade, fits on a socket on the motherboard. And like I said, I had the 65816 in there. So how do we get started on the Apple with CPM? Well, there's a couple of things that we do here. One of them is you want to choose your hardware. Apple Win actually emulates the CPM card, and when I do the demo here, we'll actually use that instead of using the real hardware. If you want to see the real hardware run later, that's great. There is a drawback of using the emulator, though. CPM is very driver dependent, and a lot of the things that you want to do, that BIOS section, like for example, most of the CPM versions support the Unidisk. And you have to load a driver within the CPM operating system itself to support the Unidisk, but it will support the 3.5 Unidisk. And they actually called that mass storage back then. So one of the other interesting things about the Apple II is you have to get the correct version of CPU for the card that you're running. Some of them will run across the different hardware platforms, some of them will not. For example, the CPAM will not run on the Z80 soft card. Could not get it to work. It'll error out on it. So there are subtle differences in the versions of the operating system that actually take advantage of the hardware in there. Make some boot disks. There is a gentleman out there that has a blog post that if you have one of the CFFA 3000s. You can actually boot CPM off of that. And you can actually, there's a program out there that I've been trying to find. If anybody has it here, I'd like a copy. It's called ProPart. It actually creates a ProDOS partition that you can copy CPM and actually run it from a hard disk. It is out there, but every version out there is corrupt. I have not, there's one, there's, they posted it in a Google group that died about 5 years ago, and so nobody's actually maintaining that, but it was a program called ProPart that you need with the PCPI card, and you can actually have it run off of a 32 meg ProDOS partition. Then you can download software, and there are tons of places, Asimov, there's tons of places to get CPM software. The interesting thing with the Apple is that if you go and you get CPM 80 software from that runs on all of the other platforms, and you can somehow get it over onto a ProDOS disk and then onto a CPM Apple CPM disk, chances are the program is going to run because CPM 80 was CPM 80. Now there are different versions of it out there. Obviously CPM 86, which was for the 8086, will not run on the CPM 80. But you can get some of these games that were written for the Jupiter 3 that were written in CPM 80, and if you can get them over onto the Apple CPM formatted disk, they'll run. And read the CPM user's guide to familiarize yourself with the commands, and don't forget about pip. So let me go ahead and do a quick demo of some of the CPM stuff here now. And let me flip back to duplicating the screen. And promised myself this year I wouldn't get sidetracked with stories, so I think I did okay here. So let's look for, I will boot there. And again, this is Apple Win, and where's the, that's it there. Okay, and when CPM boots up, this is the CPAM version of it from Applied Engineering, version 5.1. You see the A and the bracket there. So if we do issue a DIR command, you'll see that anything that ends in a .com is one of the external commands that I've talked to you about, or a program that does something on there. Now, this was the one that was designed to run on, like I said, either the Applied Engineering card for the Apple II and IIe, or the Applied Engineering cards for the Apple IIc. Okay. For the Apple IIc. So when you get it up and running and you need to load and get the rest of your hardware on there, there's a program called PC, Peripheral Configuration, not personal computer. So you run PC and basically it lists your drive names and your device names, and A through F. So you'll see that they're all Apple Disk IIs now because that's all the emulator understands, and I'll show you this. This is where the emulator falls a little short and the hardware is a little bit better. So when I hit A to add something, you'll see that there's a RAM card and a smart port emulated in the emulator. Well, the smart port doesn't have a slot associated with it. Normally it would have a slot 5 associated with it on the Apple IIc. So what you essentially would do here is you pick the slot number 5, and then it'll ask you to load the driver file. So the driver file for the Unidisk is unidsk.dvr, and you go to, you know, the disk, and it'll load that, and then essentially it will come back here, and then you'll see B:, you'll see the Unidisk in there, and then you'll see what unit number it is in there. Then essentially what you need to do is, once you're done with that, is you basically will save it. There'll be an option to save it there. And then it updates a file on the drive called autopc.com. And then that file runs, and that'll load when it boots up at CPM at boot time, and then that'll load all of the drivers on there. Show you just a few of the commands, and there's stat, for example. It says that the drive A:, is read-write and has 4K left. That is one of the biggest things that you'll fiddle with here. If you have a 3.5-inch drive, or if you have a CFFA, it makes it a little bit easier. But basically what you need to do with the boot disk like this is, okay, what can I delete? Well, I probably don't need... let's see, at this point, sample.sub, so I can delete that and get a few back. And you'll see the blocks are listed beside the file there, so you have to get creative to delete some of this stuff so that you can put other stuff on here to to make it a boot disk. SD is an interesting one. That'll give you a directory, but it'll kind of in a pretty format where, you know, it'll have lines dividing the files. Obviously, there's a RAM drive that you can make on here, and that helps make the boot disk, because if you make the RAM drive, you can pip a lot of the files up to the RAM drive, create a brand new disk, and then only pip the ones back that you need. Let's see, and there's submit.com, and again, you see that was one that was an external command because it's an actual COM file. Okay. Let's see, the other thing I just want to show real quick here is what a, let's see here. Why can't I get to the, I can't, let's escape out of that here. Time's up. Okay, time's up. So if you guys want to see some of the software, the WordStar and Turbo Pascal and all that, I have all that available here and can show you. So any questions real quickly? I'll be here and you can stop by. Nope. Okay.